it was divided. Some people were excited, other people were like, how dare you do that to a Porsche? That thing deserves twin turbos, it deserves shooting flames. I'm like, I could shoot flames, it just wouldn't be a good thing if I did. My love for cars started from infancy. According to my parents, my very first word was car. Interestingly, followed by light, which is very clever because nowadays I do a lot of things with EVs, but nonetheless, that's how I started. I loved cars from infancy, always loved vehicles and propulsion, just loved it. And even though as I went to school to study a different division in engineering, everything I've loved has been more mechanical. It was very important for me to use my acumen and what I learned in school to apply towards my race cars or cars I used to track quite often while I was in school and afterwards. So it's that passion for staying curious, inquisitive, figuring things out, and then having this passion of going faster that allowed me to take my knowledge and experience and infuse it into my automotive creations. It's that love of cars and that curiosity that keeps me till today to stay within the ranks of automotive culture and continue to push the envelope year after year. I had an opportunity to work in different facets of life that are more near and dear to my background in chemical engineering. I had a brief stint in pharmaceutical research, got into pharmaceutical sales. I've done quite a few things, got into electronic sales, and still my path continued to push me towards automotive. And knowing that I've experienced other things and thinking back to my passion around those things, nothing's like cars. That's a good question. How did I get to where I am today? Wow. You know, it's very difficult. I'm going to take a slight tangent here. It's very difficult to kind of be a contrarian, to be someone who does things that is not, you know, accepted initially or is kind of forward thinking. We tend to get a lot of scrutiny, and a lot of people don't sometimes like what we do because we typically do what's not commonplace or what's hip or what's popular. That passion to always improve is something I do in my own life, where every day I feel the need to be better than I was the day before. That mindset extrapolates into my creations here at Bisimoto. So with my team, we constantly look for ways to create things and make them better and better each time. And especially for our clients, to make their driving experience very enjoyable, fun, and reliable. So that is what pushes me to do something better than before. It's just that desire to be a better person on a daily basis. So what makes this really rewarding for me is the fact that we can have something on paper and then bring it to reality. So for example, my dream car is a 917, and we just discussed it with the team yesterday evening. So imagine us just talking about it a night before, and then 6 months later, it's here and we're driving it. And then I'm driving that and it's really exciting. And then someone sees me on the road, like, build one for me. That's even more exciting. So the fact that we can have something concept and bring it to life, and a lot of people can do that. There are billions of people on this planet who may have a dream project and it's just a dream. They can't make it a reality. The fact that Tim and I can come up with concepts and bring it to life is one of the most rewarding things ever. There's a combination of two things when it comes to me building cars. On one hand, I can have vehicles that have a particular goal where I want to explore a certain facet of the market that's never been explored before, or I want to experience technologies that are still in its infancy or on the rise. On the other hand, it could be something where a client comes to me and gives me a very interesting, how should I say, goal to achieve. And since the team and I are not afraid of the unknown, it's very exciting to create things that haven't been done before, or better yet, walk a path that's least, or if at all, ventured. My inspiration for automotive builds really comes from the Porsche racing heritage when it comes to aesthetics. When it comes to technology, it's really discussions that I have with my in-house team here and how I want to push the envelope to make things more exciting and more efficient. So from an engineering perspective, that's really internal, but from an aesthetic, it's really that pedigree of Porsche racing, especially Group 5, that I find so much appeal for and love to pay homage to such creations of the past. My latest creation is actually right here next to me, the Bisimoto MOBY X. It's a 640 horsepower, fully electric vehicle, paying homage to the old Moby Dick that Porsche used to race in Group 5, and it's absolutely fantastic. Also next to me is this beautiful 65 Volkswagen Type 2 van or bus, which makes 450 horsepower. Yes, 450 horsepower in a van, and it's absolutely a blast to drive. And coming soon is a Neo EP9 that we're doing for one of our clients that's gonna be a 1300 horsepower twin motor monster. In addition to a very secret project we're building right now that, how can I say, involves a classic early model Rolls-Royce Silver Shadow. That's all I can say for now. Was there ever a point where I thought I should stop or give up? No. I have always been contrarian. From my drag racing days, racing single cam D series when everyone else was doing twin cams with Honda and Acura, H motors and twin B series. I've been used to blazing my own path and doing something, not caring about what people said or did. And even then, people asked me why I was building such a junk engine. And then I upgraded to a Honda F series, same thing. So I'm accustomed to naysaying. It's just, as far as I'm concerned, a way of life. As a matter of fact, it's come to a point nowadays that if I'm not scrutinized, I must be doing something wrong. If I build something and everyone's like, yay, I'm like, uh-oh. It's too commonplace, something's wrong. I missed the mark. If people are like, how dare you, sacrilege? I'm like, yes, yes, I did it, got it. It's working. I get it daily that people tell me that I'm doing it wrong. People feel that EVs are soulless or they are not exciting whatsoever. And I'm here to share with them that as a diehard petrol head who's experienced both sides of the equation, you can't shake a stick at it. It is fast and fun. And performance EVs can be a lot of fun. I get it for individuals who their first experience may have been a Tesla Model S, maybe a P100D or a Plaid. When you're driving those, you're kind of disconnected a little bit from the driving experience, just a little bit. But in a Bisimoto performance EV, you have the performance of what you would see of a newer Tesla, but you have that analog feeling that's still there. You're still connected to the tarmac more. You have the tire feedback, the steering feedback. The cars feel like old cars, but updated or upcycled with modern technology. The two vehicles that are near and dear mean a lot to me. One is the minivan that I built a few years ago for American Honda, the 2014 Odyssey that makes 1,029 horsepower. I still have it in my arsenal. That thing is fantastic. And not only is it shocking to have a dad van that makes a lot of power, it's a 6-speed manual, with a V6 that's fully built, with a turbo that's bigger than most people's heads. And it's just a blast and very, very popular. Of all the cars I've built, it's probably the most popular car I've had. It's been on multiple television shows, from Top Gear to shows on Netflix. It has a Hot Wheel built around it. It's absolutely a blast. And it was a car that I built as an individual who started a young family and didn't want to give up my need for speed. So it was like the perfect combination of a family hauler but still performance oriented, and it hit the mark perfectly. Another car that is very near and dear to me is the Bisimoto K3V. That Porsche really opened my eyes to the possibilities of performance electric vehicles. It's a vehicle that is very beautiful and pays homage to the old school Group 5 racing with 935s, and just an eye catcher. Just, you see this thing on the freeway, on the 405 freeway, and it gets glances and just rubberneckers left and right. So that car has really changed my life and open my eyes to the possibility of high-performance electric vehicles. The advice I have to young individuals who want to get into business is to explore it. It's a very exciting arena. Very few people on this planet can put something on paper, talk about it, and bring it to life and drive it in a few months. So there's many benefits in being able to explore such an arena. Also, hot rodding is a lot of fun. I can't think of other careers that can allow you to have the creativity and flexibility that automotive culture and building cars of this nature can provide. On the flip side of that, it does take a lot of dedication. The team and I know how difficult and hard it is to be able to bring creations to life. It takes a lot of discipline and a lot of perseverance, especially if you're blazing a new trail. You'll have a lot of naysayers that may want to put you down. Don't let them get to you. Stay persistent, stay dedicated, and those results will come to fruition and be very, very advantageous. SEMA has been really a very influential outfit organization for us builders. From back in the day when I used to tune petrol cars to now with EVs, they've been really good supporters of my journey. My first SEMA was in 1995. I had the opportunity to attend under one of my sponsors, and wow, it blew my mind. The creativity, the performance in the Central Hall was just mind-blowing. And in South Hall, I had the opportunity to see things that were more aesthetic in nature. So whether I loved, which I did, whether I loved things that were bling, or I wanted things that were show and go, it had it all. And fast forward to today, oh my goodness, the industry has changed so much. There are so much more advancements in technology, and SEMA is there to embrace all of it. Whether it's from the petrol side, overlanding, off-roading, car stereo, or even electric vehicles, and the manufacturers as well, it's a place, almost a mecca for me, where I have to go and see what's new in technology, what's new in safety, and what's new in mobility. It's a place to, once again, what I love, celebrate the old and embrace the new. Being able to see new automotive trends is what excites me the most about going to SEMA. It's a place where, whether you're looking at OEM opportunities or especially aftermarket, which I embrace so much, that is the place to be. Now, when it comes to some of the things that I find extremely appealing about SEMA is the camaraderie. It's a place where I can go as a SEMA member, meet other members, talk shop, talk about new technologies, and create opportunities for even more advancement in tech. When it comes to anything business-wise, networking is key. The SEMA show provides the perfect environment for me to meet other individuals who are like-minded in nature, to be able to discuss opportunities to work together and push the industry forward as a whole. We are in a very unique timeline, a place where we can experience everything from petrol vehicles that are natural aspirated, to supercharging, to turbocharging, to alternative fuels, to now EVs that allow us packaging that's different and can give us a lot more opportunities to have freedom in design language and culture. It is very rare for an individual to exist where you can have access to these different methods of propulsion, hydrogen, electric, petrol, you name it. So that being said, especially now that the EV space is almost like the Wild Wild West, where we have opportunities for creativity and advancement, I think we're in a very special time in automotive culture and a place where we as individuals and builders can influence the future and keep hot rodding and creativity going in the automotive space.